And you, I just remembered, you earlier described the Philippines' response to the ICC's drug war case during the Duterte administration as namamangka sa dalawang ilog, trying to row down two rivers. Do you expect this strategy to continue given the recent decision, or are you expecting a shift in the demeanor or attitude on how the government responds to this case?
The Philippine government under Marcos, and perhaps to the extent that he can influence Marcos through Duterte, perhaps to his daughter, the Philippine government will continue the strategy of obstructing justice while spreading disinformation about this case. It will continue to obstruct by claiming that the ICC has no jurisdiction, despite the fact that the Philippine government has participated in the litigation so far, contrary to what the Justice Secretary of Marcos keep saying, that they will not cooperate, that they will not participate. The fact that they filed an appeal means that they have accepted the ICC's jurisdiction over this investigation, even if they claim that that jurisdiction is gone. But that's only half of their strategy. The other half is disinformation. The constant claim of Rodrigo Duterte that the ICC consists of Western judges. There are a lot of Western judges in the ICC, but if you look at the five judges that decided the appeal of the Philippine government yesterday, you'll see a French judge, a Polish judge, a Georgian judge, a Ugandan judge, and a Peruvian judge. So you have a diversity of judges that decided the appeal. But more than that, and this is very important, the Marcos government has paid a law firm in the United Kingdom based in London called Bedford Nine, headed by a lawyer named Stephen Kay, who has in the past represented, for example, Uhuru Kenyatta, former president of Kenya, charged with murder and rape of thousands of Kenyans during post-election violence in that country. After Kenyatta and other defendants appeared at the ICC and questioned the ICC's jurisdiction over them, witnesses started to be killed or disappeared in Kenya. By today, 13 of those persons, witnesses or persons who were co-defendants, have been killed in Kenya. And of course, the UK law firm will claim that it has nothing to do with those. And that's probably true. But at the same time, they have never clarified what they thought of their clients' involvement in those cases. Now, the same law firm was paid $17 million by the president of South Sudan to also defend him in charges involving war crimes in that country. And there is a pattern in which witnesses are intimidated, victims are harassed, and this is the same law firm that the Marcos government has hired to represent the Philippines. So essentially, what the Philippines is trying to do is to dress up the lack of an argument, factual support for its claim that drug war killings are being investigated by the Philippines and that the ICC should not step into these cases, by dressing them up with a UK law firm that is, I should really say it, that has associated itself with impunity, that has associated itself with heads of state that have not hesitated to harass and intimidate witnesses and persons involved in a case.
Okay, you mentioned that there is a pattern among clients of Bedford Nine. So far, of these patterns, what are you seeing in the Philippines? What is happening right now that has happened in Kenya and other countries that Bedford Nine took in as clients?
Again, let me be very clear. I'm not saying that Bedford Nine or the lawyers in Bedford Nine are involved in these acts that clearly are meant to intimidate or even harm witnesses and other parties. I am saying that their clients are linked to those acts. It's in the Philippines. There have been instances where during the drug war itself, and up to now, families of victims are threatened that they will be the ones to be arrested or even killed if they don't turn over persons that are supposed to be linked to drug dealing in the Philippines. For example, you have witnesses that have fled the country and whose statements have been instrumental in the investigation so far of the ICC prosecutor, who are afraid to return to the Philippines, who are also afraid for their family members that might still be in the Philippines. Now, this is, of course, a case that involves extrajudicial killings in the thousands, and so it is not remote to be afraid that these killings will continue but extend beyond those alleged to be part of drug dealing, but go into the killing of witnesses or persons that might be close to witnesses, just to harass, just to drive fear into the families of victims.
Okay, and finally, Attorney Carranza, what can the families of drug war victims do to actually ensure that the case will continue, that there would be enough space for investigations to happen here in the Philippines, considering that, as we mentioned earlier, the current administration continues to refuse to recognize the jurisdiction of the ICC here?
Marcos Jr. wants to sell an image of himself as not Marcos Sr., or at least not a dictator like his father, without necessarily cutting off that relationship. He wants to sell an image of himself as not linked to the past, and he has said that. The problem, of course, is that he's a Marcos, and that's going to be difficult. One way for him to show perhaps that he can rise above the reputation of his family for corruption, for human rights violations, is to actually cooperate with the ICC. Other than that, then it's very unlikely that the Marcos administration will help victims seek gain justice. Now, what's important for victims' families right now is their own safety. It's important to do no harm. And I'm glad that Philippine news outlets and journalists have tried their best to protect the identities of families of victims and witnesses. I think it's important to continue to protect them, to continue to put them outside of harm's way. But I think it's also important for policymakers in the Philippines, the few members of the Senate or the House of Representatives or even other government agencies, to assist these families who have lost breadwinners, who have lost their livelihoods because of the drug war. Justice at the ICC will take very long. It's very possible that families will get not just tired, but face a difficult life trying to sustain their interest in seeking justice. It's important that they be given material support in doing so.
All right, and we will have to leave it at that as we wait for the next step of ICC prosecutors working on this case. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Attorney Ruben Carranza.
Thank you for having me.